Joint Committee on Appropriations will come to order. Mr. Secretary, call the roll, please.
Representative Gross.
Here.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Here.
Representative Duba.
Here.
Senator Wick.
Here.
Representative Haugard.
Here.
Senator Nezeba.
Here.
Senator Johnson. Representative May.
Here.
Representative Mills.
Here.
Senator Maher. Yep. Representative Mullally.
Here.
Senator Colbeck.
Here.
Senator Sutton.
Here.
Senator Greenfield.
Yep.
Senator Breitling.
Here.
Representative Howard.
Excused.
Senator Hunhoff.
Here.
Representative Carr.
Here.
We have a quorum.
We have a quorum. Thank you very much. Well, good morning, Joint Appropriations and members in the room, folks in the room. Good to see everybody again. It's been a while. Missed you guys. Today we have...
The loss has been found.
Feelings mutual. Good. I like it. So we have some bills up today, and I just want to clarify a few things before we go any further. HB 1031, we heard that in House Appropriations yesterday, and that passed out. So we will not be hearing that again. You can cross that off the list. I apologize if anybody showed up today to testify on that, but that bill has been dealt with. So the three bills that we will have hearings for is 1047, HB 1194, HB 1264, and then we have several bills below the line that have had hearings that we will take action on. And so those include SB 63, SB 49, SB 48, SB 41, SB 51, SB 34, SB 31, HB 1071. Just want to give everybody kind of heads up on the agenda this morning. Before we go any further, though, I'd like to ask everybody to stand. We're going to do the Pledge of Allegiance together. And I'm going to ask Senator Breitling to lead us, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you very much. Should we sing the Star Spangled Banner as well? You start. Do we have any minutes? Senator Sutton.
I move that we approve the minutes of Monday, February 14th, 2022.
I have a motion by Senator Sutton to approve the minutes from February 14th, and a second by Representative Mills. Comments?
BFM and the Legislative Research Council presented the revenue projection for FY 22 and 23, and five bills were heard and deferred.
Okay. Any other comments? Seeing none, this is a voice vote. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Those minutes are passed. Thank you. Any other minutes? Okay. Seeing none. We have new pages this week. This is our second day on the job. Welcome. I'm going to invite you to come up to a microphone, introduce yourself, tell us your name, where you're from, and what are your plans after high school?
Hello, everyone. Good morning. My name is Aida Desaunier. I'm from Sioux Falls. I go to the Lincoln High School. I'm a junior, and I still have a little bit of time, but I'm thinking about majoring in education or interior design. Thank you for having us.
Excellent. Thanks for being here.
Hello, everyone. I am Max Lightfield. I am from Millbank, and I am also a junior, and I am not entirely sure what I'm going to pursue yet.
Oh, there's still hope.
Hello, my name is Michael Wagner. I'm a senior at Roosevelt High School in Sioux Falls. After high school, I plan on attending USD, major in legal studies.
Excellent. Thank you for being here. Okay, we are going to get right into our agenda. We have House Bill 1047 to make an appropriation to the Department of Education to improve and renovate the Cultural Heritage Center and to declare an emergency. And welcome proponents. Good morning.
Is it? There we go.
Let me just make sure this is shared
online. Yeah, and then share. Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
Is this a document that's posted on the LRC website?
Yes, it should be under Bill Hearing Documents.
Bill Hearing?
1047 slides.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the Joint Appropriations Committee. My name is Dr. Ben Jones, and I'm the State Historian and Director of the State Historical Society. I'm pleased to be here today to share information with you regarding HB 1047, a special appropriation that is a part of the Governor's proposed budget. The bill appropriates $8.8 million from the General Fund and $3.3 million in other fund authority for the purpose of renovating and modernizing the Cultural Heritage Center. The Cultural Heritage Center opened in 1989. As this story by Joe Kafka in the Rapid City Journal explains, the state legislature at the time appropriated $6.5 million for the effort. Also, the Heritage Fund, or its successor, the South Dakota Historical Society Foundation, raised $2.8 million to create the exhibits to fill the museum portion of the building. In today's dollars, that would be $14.7 million of general funds and $7.4 million in other funds. We are now at a point where the building needs the M&R and the functional improvements. We are also running out of artifact space and seek to update the exhibits. So we bring before your consideration a concept that will take advantage of the original design and fund the project in the original way. In the 1980s, they didn't know when they would need more artifact or archival space, but they designed a building that could be modified to provide that when needed. And when the M&R issues are resolved, and when the building storage spaces are expanded in ways that it was originally designed to expand, our history will have a long future ahead of it. So 32 years later, HB 1047 asked that this same financial model be used to renovate the Cultural Heritage Center that was used to build it. This slide, and over the next few slides, I'll refresh your memory of what some of the details were that we shared on the 24th of January in the DOE budget presentation. Over the summer, we worked with the State Engineer's Office and the Bureau of Administration. They hired a company called ISG to help us understand the challenges and develop a design that resolves the issues, with the exception of the museum exhibits. Construction plans cover four major areas: fixing the deferred maintenance, modernizing and expanding the museum and public spaces, updating the office spaces, and maximizing the archival and artifact storage. The plan for funding this entire project includes general funds, privately raised funds, and state M&R funding. Moving forward, the building would be kept up under the state's M&R plan, which wasn't available in prior years. Now this slide, therefore we first go over the M&R spending. From the previous presentation, there were questions on the purpose of the M&R funding the need. And while the M&R funding is not in this bill, the M&R work would be done concurrently by the same contractor so we can capture greater efficiencies. The estimated M&R costs break down as illustrated here in this pie chart. 73.11% is architectural and structural, which is largely comprised of the building's sod roof, replacing that. The estimated costs on removing the sod, repairing the structural roof, and putting new sod back on is $5 million. So that eats up the lion's share of the M&R costs. This would be the building's third roof, but materials have improved since the last one was put on, and the thinking is that this would be a far long-lasting investment than the previous style roof. The materials have improved underneath the sod that make the building last, making the roof last longer. Therefore, we'd ask the contractor to help us envision such options with these materials and avoid the long-term cost of replacing the roof every 15 years or so. We'd also seek to maintain the Arikara earthen style structure with any future design. And the remaining 37% of the costs are for aspects of the work regarding the vehicle entry grade of the parking, the HVAC upgrades, and the electrical upgrades. If you have questions about this process or so forth, Commissioner Bollinger is here and would be happy to ask answer those questions. Now, beyond those issues, HB 1047 then would tackle the issues you see on this slide. Our museum shares the state's stories, but speaks to an audience of the 1990s. So we would update the audio, the video, think about how to use augmented reality and other technology necessary to provide a more impactful and experience for our visitors. Our education room needs space for students of all ages and upgraded in technology for presentation and other educational activities. The building was designed prior to the passage of the ADA, and we would seek to use the best of ideas regarding ADA so that all can enjoy the facility. Moving large items in and out and around the museum has been difficult due to the placement of some walls, and so we would redesign those. We'd redesign the lobby with a better reception desk, updated bathrooms, and a space for researchers to have lunch and a snack bar. The press, the Historical Society Press, which has endured, enjoyed so much success, didn't exist when the building was built. And so it currently stores all the books that are out for shipment and management control in the service hallway in the back. So we would alter the loading dock from a two-truck loading dock to a one-truck loading dock and convert that to storage space. More importantly, though, in the last bit here, in collecting our history, the archives consumes 300 to 350 cubic feet of space every year. That's been the average consumption rate of the last 5 years. And so we are quickly running out of space. In 4 years, we estimate the archives will be out of space. The museum artifact storage will be out of space at about the same time. The rare book collection, our library, is out of space now. So by putting in the mezzanine levels into the building, that and to use that option that was designed into the building in 1989, this would increase our capacity and give us another 30 to 40 years of life for the archival and artifact storage. This slide we showed previously, it's a concept. That ISG did for rendering us. It's the first draft, if you will, of a design. As you may recall from the presentation on the 24th, this concept shows a new gathering space that can accommodate larger groups and the extended offices in the front. What the concept doesn't show and what needs to be revisited is the parking lot entrance. The current entrance's grade is too steep for many buses. We'd seek to change that parking lot entrance from what you see here, just off the concept side. Also, we'd revisit the pedestrian approach to the building, the distance from the parking lot to the door, and Representative Mills brought up a concern about those main doors being too close. We'd work a lot of that through, as well as we, should the 1047 be approved, that we go to a firm plan. We take all those things into consideration. The state engineer and the ISG have confirmed that the stresses on the building can be remedied and that this would give the building a far longer life by doing so. One of the first tasks that 1047 passes will be to do soil testing in order to determine what kind of measures are best to fix the stress issues. But whatever the issues are, the engineers are confident that they can be solved. And maintaining and improving our current building is a far more cost-effective way to collect and preserve our state's history than building a new building would be. On the next slide, I have the interior design concept. Here, the lobby, which is in deep purple, and the lodge, which is in gray, connect to the museum and the public research via the lobby. The archival library is enlarged by moving a wall, and that gives us more shelves and more life for the rare book collection. The mezzanine floors are installed above the artifact museum storage and above the archives to give those more square footage of space to create essentially a second floor in those storage spaces. Many of you have been in there before and you've seen those high ceilings. Those were built with the option of putting in a mezzanine floor and giving us more square footage later when it's needed. We have a conservator space that's not been used for that purpose in the past. That would be repurposed for digitization, which also really didn't exist at the time this building was built. Now we do a great deal of that work, both in the Cultural Heritage Center and at the Women's Prison. We would consolidate all of those capacities, bringing our staff person from the Women's Prison to this building, making that workflow a lot more efficient. The loading dock, which is in light blue, goes from two stalls to one, giving us that increased storage book inventory I spoke of. And we'd redesign the inventory management for shipping for the press. The public and the staff bathrooms would be modernized. We'd have a mother's room installed and staff workspace for the press. The Historic Preservation Office, admin, and the foundation would be updated and more file storage would be added. Next slide. This slide shows the estimated costs broken down by ISG and the State Engineer's Office. Let me get to the. Again, it's important to see that this is a combined project with M&R, general funds, and other funds. So $3 million would be raised privately with $250,000 of museum funds, so that's the other funds. And then the funds provided by 1047 in the top right box. General funds, $8.8 million. Other fund authority, $3.3 million. Should the legislature approve, there's an emergency clause in the bill, so we would be able to let the bids out immediately. The state engineer intends to use the construction manager at risk model so that costs are contained to those you see here, and it provides us a single manager for the entire project. Regarding the timeline, we'd work along the final plans, finalize those this spring and summer, develop a movement plan for storage, determine a start date, communicate what we'd expect to use to the public as far as the building's availability to the public, and begin work this fall. The project would be a complex one with things moving interiorly. We're trying to utilize the space in the museum to store the artifacts that are in the museum storage or in the archival storage so that we don't wind up putting 37,000 artifacts from the museum on trucks into the secure climate-controlled storage elsewhere. We'd like to maintain as much of that as we can in the building. And by using the museum gallery, we can keep those in the building and under our own secure and climate-controlled roof. Then we would come up with a plan to move those things back into the new storage place once the mezzanines are built, and then swap from whatever was in the museum first place. Let's say the archives goes in there, and the archives mezzanines get built, and that area is refurbished and redone. Then we'd move the archives back into their new space. Then the museum artifacts will go into the museum gallery. While the museum artifact space, the mezzanines and so forth are put in, and then those artifacts will be put back in the new mezzanine space. And then all along that time, the foundation, we would ask the foundation to conduct a fundraising campaign to provide the capacity for upgrading the exhibits. And the Bureau of Administration will work with us on temporary offices as we need to shuffle people to workspaces out of the building should that, when that need arises for them. The museum's reopen pace would be later, and would be determined by the fundraising efforts and the work on the exhibits. So, with that, I'll conclude my presentation and stand by for any questions. And I believe I have somebody who's another proponent testifying.
Okay. We're going to hold questions till the end. We'll go to further proponent testimony.
Hello, Chair and committee members. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Will you just identify yourself and then you can proceed?
Thank you. My name is Tom Hilbert. I'm co-founder of Co-op Architecture with offices in Sioux Falls, Aberdeen, and Rapid City. And I'm the architect appointed trustee and vice president of the State Historical Society. And I would like to corroborate what the director has pointed out, in my professional opinion, the absolute need for this project. The issues that he identified are real and substantial. The planning shown, I believe, is reasonable, and I'd like to ask you to please provide the resources for the necessary repairs and improvements to serve South Dakotans to preserve our history for years to come. I think this is a special place and a special project. Please support the HB 1047. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Hurlbert. And any further proponent testimony? Any additional proponent testimony? Last chance. Any proponents? Okay, seeing none, we'll move to any opponent testimony. Opponent testimony. Any opponent testimony? Seeing none, we're going to close public testimony. We're going to go into questions. Committee questions. Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This might be for Mr. Hurlbert. Since you're an architect, I know there was some discussion about the roof, the sod roof. I note the new addition on the front has some different kind of roof. I'm wondering if there's been any consideration to utilizing a sod roof for that new addition on the front.
I'm not aware of that at this moment, so I'd have to defer to the director.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead. Will you just state your name again?
Sure. Ben Jones, State Historian and Director of the Historical Society. Representative Mills, the gathering space as such, I believe the materials that they're thinking about is, I forget the name, but it's kind of a rust steel, and that would be the walls, the exterior wall siding, and then also it would perform the function on the roof.
Mr. Chair, follow up.
Go ahead.
So I wasn't speaking about the gathering space so much. I think it's that mezzanine or that addition that comes out to the front, that has a long, very relatively flat roof. It looked like it would be easily maybe that would be a possibility. And it's one of the really unique things about this museum that I think people don't really recognize when they go there, but they would if that lower roof had the sod and they could really see that grass growing up there. I just think it might be a way to make use of the new technology that you said was better and to showcase what's really happening in that building. And so I just wondered if it was a possibility to consider that option.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Yes, as I understand your question, I think that's a good idea to tie the two parts of the structure together. So we'll take a look at that.
Well,
thank you.
You bet. I'm going to ask some questions about the roof because that's one of the things that strikes me too. And just help me understand what you said. There's this new technology. It'll help with the life of the roof. How long are we expecting to get out of this roof?
Mr. Chair, I think I'll defer to Scott Bollinger for the facility questions.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Scott
morning.
Bollinger, Bureau of Administration. The current earthen roof that we have, I think one of the problems in the earlier designs is the lack of drainage that has caused part of the problems and why the roofs don't last as long. So we're looking at that being a component of what we do when we replace the existing roof. Inherent with any earthen roof, you know, if it comes into contact with metal, you have to worry about rust. But it's a case of we're going to look at all options related to the roof, whether it be even that mezzanine roof or the main roof, to look at the new technologies that will help us drain the water away from the building and off the roof and keep it dry so it'll last. But our intentions are we think we can get 20 to 25 years out of the next roof.
And so my other question is, it's unique. It's but you know, you start talking about $5 million, and maybe that's nothing. This is not my wheelhouse. You know, commercial construction, things like this. But did you look at other alternatives to go, maybe we shouldn't do the earthen sod roof? Maybe we should just do a steel roof.
Mr. Chairman,
go ahead.
It's under discussion. We haven't finalized which roof design we're actually going to use. We're trying to stay as much as we can with the original design that the building had, but we're also going to look at alternative roofs that may serve us better for the long haul. But we haven't gotten far enough with the architect until this gets funded to determine what's the most cost-effective roof that we can put on there. But part of the reason for the $5 million bill is when you've got several feet of earth over the roof, it's not like you can drive an excavator on top of it and start digging it off. You have to be very careful that we don't collapse the roof underneath. So it takes more labor and time to get that earth off. And you have to be conscious of the fact that once that's open, and we're doing it in the summertime when it could rain, to make sure that the water doesn't end up in the building and damaging anything inside. So that's part of the reason that the cost is so high.
Okay. Yeah, I was just thinking through it. I understand it's more complicated than probably tearing off a layer of shingles. But, you know, just when you're weighing out the different types of materials, you know, the steel roofs, they can look really sharp, and I see them in commercial use a lot, and they last a long time. So I understand the aesthetics maybe isn't exactly what you might be going for, but something to consider as far as from a cost standpoint. I think what's inside the building is probably more important. Myself, that's my two cents. I do think I saw the other day somebody driving up on there, like a truck. Is that possible? Was it maybe just a lost hunter?
Mr. Chair, you probably saw the ISG.
I think it was
working on this.
Right? Some sort of utility or engineering truck. Okay. Other questions? Any other questions from the committee? Senator Nessaba.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. And just a question for Mr. Jones. We've spent part of this legislative session talking about what's appropriate to talk about in classrooms, about whether we can talk about divisive topics, what fulfills a patriotic education. And I'm just wondering, does a museum share the administration's same philosophy? Can we have history exhibits that talk about parts of our history that we're not particularly proud of? One of the most powerful exhibits I ever went to is the Imperial War Museum. And up on the third floor in London, they have an exhibit about the Holocaust. And it's deeply uncomfortable. Sure. It reduced me to tears. And I'm just curious about...
That's about...
Yeah. And so it's a question about programming. It's a question about programming and what kind of programming is going to be in this museum and whether it's consistent or not.
Today's bill is really about the construction of the building, and you want to talk about what programs or I guess the I don't know if you want to say curriculum or whatever the exhibits, and I think those are two different things. So I'd like to stick to the construction of this building.
And Mr. Chair, that my concern here simply is whether what kind of history? Could you give us an example of what some of the programming that might be in this building that would reflect that? Would that seem appropriate? I mean, we're talking about $8 million worth of general fund spending here, and I just want to know what are people of South Dakota going to learn when they come to see this space?
Mr. Jones, can you just tell us again? I think we've had the presentation when the Department of Ed was here, and I think we've had the opportunity to tour. What's offered in the Cultural Heritage Center? Just give us the 60-second commercial. If we go there, you know, what can we see, and what do you house there?
Sure. So as you walk into the museum, one of the first exhibits you see is the Ocheti-Shakowin exhibits that were designed in the early 1990s. It was the second main part designed by the museum exhibit, done with a great deal of care with advisory council and so forth from around the state. And then as you walk through that, you'll see the beginning of Western, the Vérendrye plates, the Frenchman, who came to Dakota, well, before it was Dakota Territory, who walked through this area. And then all of the territorial, Dakota Territory history, a good bit of that. And then as you go into the last part, we call changing times, the 20th century displays, which include a wide variety of issues that I think the senator is pointing out, from Wounded Knee. There's a display regarding that, and a wide variety of things that are in there that are relevant to our history.
I'm going to ask you another question. So this bill doesn't contemplate and or dictate what exhibits are in this building, but if one wanted to have some input or provide a suggestion or have a conversation, what's the appropriate avenue to do that? Is there a way for South Dakotans to say, you know what, I think there's a piece of history that's missing here? Is there an avenue to have that conversation?
There sure is. They can go to our website and see what's on there now, and as we begin the discussion with that, with the foundation and the campaign, most of the exhibit will be raised by the foundation, and so we'll set up a way to participate in that discussion.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to move into a different line of questioning at this point. So, Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So, I'm looking at the drawing here on the Cultural Heritage Center, and then you alluded earlier to the Arikara. Can you elaborate on how that discussion lines up with this design?
Sure. The Arikara were a tribe of Native Americans who lived along this river. In fact, there's archaeological evidence that they had a community right over along the street here. And they were here from the 1500s earlier, perhaps, 1400s, 1500s, 1600s, until about the 1820s, 30s, and 40s. And then were depleted due to the smallpox outbreak that occurred at the time and the Lakota that moved into the area. And now the Arikara tribe is a part of the three federated tribes with the headquarters in North Dakota.
Okay, but the design of the building you said is reflective of the culture.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Yes, so they had earthen lodges. That was their structures that they lived in. So it reflects that history of the Arikara tribe, similar to the Mandans also that were in the area.
Thank you. Additional questions? Representative Duba, did you still have a question?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. So when we toured the museum, I also looked at the plans. I remember that you're going to change the way that the lobby looks, and then you're going to allow for some different exhibits. Can you just give us a little bit more on that in terms of, you know, the design that you're changing and why you're changing it? It's a little bit more open, as I recall, correct?
Mr. Chair. The lobby, yes, the lobby would have some more, there's not a lot of light that gets into that lobby due to the construction and the design and so forth. So we would look at ways to get more natural light into the lobby. That's one of the reasons why in that gathering space that's outside, I think in the depiction they kind of look like a silver berm that actually is translucent glass to let natural light into that gathering space, through the roof and then through the sides. Also, with the exhibits. When you go to a museum that's been designed or redesigned in the last decade or so, 4 to 5 years, often they will give you some type of proximity card that can tell you either through an audio signal or through some other device that as you approach an exhibit, it starts telling you about the exhibit. You might also, before your arrival, note what you're really interested in seeing. And before you leave, it would make sure that you saw it, so you didn't miss something that you came to see and were disappointed. Also, that if you participated in an activity, that you could take that score or the memory of that activity, and it could go up into the cloud, and then that could be something that you would revisit later from your house. So there's a lot of things that our museums are doing with interactivity, and by cloud, I mean a data storage cloud. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things that are being done with interactivity direct support to the classrooms. As a part of DOE and as a former secretary, I'm very cognizant of the opportunity to take things that are in our archives, and as we scan them and make them more accessible, to make them easy for teachers to use in their history classes, in their geography classes, in their civics classes.
Follow up.
So is our intent to use those, that type of technology in the new museum? Is that part of this whole redesign?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Okay, any other questions from the committee? Any other questions? Seeing none, we will close the question portion. Thank you. Thank you for being available as well, Mr. Hurlburt. We're going to move into committee action and or discussion.
Mr. Chair.
Representative Mills.
I would move due pass on House Bill 1047.
Second. Motion by Representative Mills, seconded by Senator Sutton. Due pass. Comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, I think this is a great project. It benefits all of South Dakota. It's timely. I'm encouraged because the facility had a long-range plan from the very beginning that allowed for this expansion under the structure and the roof that's there. I think that was wise in the beginning, and this is the right time for this. I would put in a quick pitch, I guess, for the earthen roof to stay with that for a number of reasons. I think that connection with the Arikara is very central to the the mission here. I would encourage it to be seriously considered for that one component on the new front as well, because I think that really would display that earthen roof. And I just want to say that I think the earthen roof provides some benefits you may not think about. There's an energy efficiency component to that that many people don't think about. While it's 10 below zero outside today, if you go down 4 feet, it's about 50 degrees. Constant temperature. And so we get that advantage by putting that several feet of dirt on top of there. And I also think that while there was an estimate of 20 to 30 years of the life of that roof, I think if that's done with the best technology that we have today and done with high craftsmanship, we could easily see 40, 50 years out of that roof, because it's such a stable environment underneath that earth, both in terms of temperature and also in terms of moisture. So if they can manage the moisture and with the new materials, I really think it'll last a long time. So I'd like to put in my 2 cents for that. I'm just very supportive of this project, and I've been in that museum several times. I'm always impressed. I always learn something. I'm grateful that it's here. So thank you. I'd urge your support of this.
Further comments on the motion? Appreciate the questions. I appreciate the discussion. And I think it's good to make sure that we are contemplating what the alternatives are. I understand the comments made about the roof. Some of us have more time to mow than others, I guess. That's okay. But as long as we're considering alternatives. Seeing no other comments on the motion, we have a motion do pass by Representative Mills, seconded by Senator Sutton. Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
18 yea, 0 nay.
It's unanimous. The motion passes. Thank you for being here this morning on House Bill 1047. We're going to move to House Bill 1194 to make an appropriation of the Office of Attorney General to temporarily fund a position within the Office of Liaison for Missing and Murdered Indigenous Persons and to declare an emergency. Representative St. John, good morning.
Good morning, committee. I would like to, first of all, thank everybody that has paid careful attention to this issue and supported the bill from last year, as well as helping all of those working on this to find a solution. And I'd like to ask that we table the bill.
Okay, we have a Can I get a motion from a committee member?
Mr. Chair.
Representative Howard.
I move to table House Bill 1194.
Second.
I have a motion by Representative Howard, second by Representative Fitzgerald to table House Bill 1194. Non-debatable motion. We call the roll, Mr. Secretary.
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson. Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
18 yeas, zero nay.
That motion passes. And Representative St. John, I just want to say thank you. Appreciate, and the next bill is dealing with the same subject matter. And the issue here is, I believe that this conversation belongs in the ongoing budget for FY23. And the Attorney General did recommend $84,000 ongoing for this position. I believe the governor recommended that that position as well, but to look for federal funds. And that's where that discussion belongs. If we're going to hire somebody, we need to look at it long term. And I think that's the intent that you would like as well. Is that correct?
Thank you. Yes, that is.
Okay. Thank you. I just want to explain, you know, for everybody that's listening as well. And I know we have one more bill coming up dealing with the same position. So House Bill 1264 makes an appropriation for the Liaison for Missing and Murdered Indigenous Persons Office and declares an emergency. Representative Poirier. Good morning.
Thank you, Chair. Madam Chair, members of the Senate and House Appropriations Committee, I'm Representative Puri Poirier, District 27. Same lines of discussions. You know, I just want to take a moment, though, before I ask for the bill to be tabled. I come from an area, you know, last year, backing up to last year, there's 77 of the total missing persons in South Dakota that were Indigenous. That's 77 of the 108. And that was, the percentages was about 71%. There's a lot of individuals, groups, community members, grassroots efforts that happen to raise this issue up. Raising this issue up to such a status where everybody, lawmakers in peer, looked at this issue and took it with serious concern. The area that I come from in District 27 in Pine Ridge, current numbers now show that in the last 6 months we had 7 homicides. And in the last 6 months, there's about 69 missing persons reports that hasn't been yet reported to the Attorney General's office. So this issue is very serious. And I applaud the governor, Governor Kristi Noem, for taking this issue and putting it on her agenda, making it a priority, and funding it for ongoing appropriations. So I appreciate her in taking this on. I appreciate everybody in the legislature who took this seriously and passed it last year. I respectfully ask for this bill to be tabled.
Thank you. Representative Haugard?
Yes, I just want to make a comment, too, that this isn't just restricted to tribal lands, either. This is, there are Native American population all across the state of South Dakota, so every one of our districts has a population that we're representing as well. So it's an important issue for all of us. And I think it's, as you point out the numbers, the missing individuals, it's maybe as much as 2/3 or more that are Native American, but there's still the rest of that population that's missing, and there needs to be attention provided to that, but especially for the Native population that seems to have been more of a victim of this than any others. So I was just making the point that every one of our districts has this as a main concern or very important concern, so we just want to point that out.
Representative Poirier.
Representative Haugard was completely right, and I meant to mention that the top three of the missing is from Rapid City and Sioux Falls. So this hits, and there is missing individuals from all the counties, so absolutely. And I meant to put that in my opening remarks. I apologize.
Thank you. Seeing no further remarks, Representative Howard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would move to table House Bill 1264.
Second.
A motion by Representative Howard, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald, to table House Bill 1264. Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Hallgard.
Aye.
Senator Nisba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Thank you.
Aye.
18 yeas, zero nay.
That motion passes. Thank you. Thank you, Representative Poirier. And I know Representative St. John had to step out, but look forward to the discussion during the ongoing budget setting when we get to the Attorney General's office, and would welcome you back to be present for that as well. We're going to move into some of the House bills that we've heard, but we've deferred, and they're Senate bills, I'm sorry. House and Senate bills that we've deferred action on, but we have heard them. What I'd like to do, give me 1 second here. We're going to go till 10 o'clock. I don't know if we'll get through all of them, but I just need to make sure that I have the right order here. Okay. We're still on? Oh, so these bills have to be out of joint by this Friday. Okay. Well, we're going to just start with what we have in order here, SB 63, then SB 49, and so on. You can look at the agenda online, and we'll just take them in order. And SB 63 revises the appropriation for road improvements to the State Veterans Cemetery to provide for ordinary operations of the cemetery and to declare an emergency. I'm going to move into committee action and discussion. Senator Hunhoff.
I move due pass of Senate Bill 63.
I have a motion by Senator Hunhoff, second by Senator Greenfield. Due pass. Comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a continuation. If you will note, last year we gave $1.5 million to the Department of Veterans Affairs for finalizing and finishing the road to the cemetery. They have received another donation of $500,000 that will help complete the project. And if there's any dollars left over, it would flow into their fund for ordinary operations of the State Veterans Cemetery. Again, these are other funds that is a result of a donation.
Other comments on this motion? Representative Gross.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I support the construction of getting this road done. I'm a little concerned, though, by the phrase in there. This is "and for ordinary operations of the state's veterans cemetery." It's never been kind of the policy of the legislature to fund the ongoing or ordinary operating expenses of the veterans cemetery. As worthy a cause as it is, there was a commitment from the veterans when it was established that they would take care of the operations on that.
Mr. Chair.
Senator Hunhoff, would you like to address that concern?
Well, if you remember, they have started a foundation and they have dollars, and those were to flow. Again, these are a donation that's being specified for the use of the cemetery. So I guess I think it falls in the realm of that because it's other funds designated by the person that made that donation and agreed that if there was any excess dollars that they could go into that fund for the operations. That then reduces the burden on further that we would have to be committed to that. That's the way I view it. Thank you.
Representative Rose, I had to go back and look at this
too. Thank you, Mr. Chair. My recollection of the testimony earlier on is that the $500,000 was specified for the construction. The new donor, the additional, the newer $500,000, my recollection is that donor specified it for construction.
We have individuals here. Would anybody care to answer that? No? Okay. Any other committee members able to answer that? Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, we appropriated the money last year in terms of the general fund allocation. To the extent that $500,000 in new money has been made available, I guess the question is, do we just require them to revert the extra $500,000, or do we allow them to utilize them for ordinary operations? And I guess we've already appropriated the monies, so we deemed it, appropriate for them to utilize those dollars. Now that dollars are freed up, I don't have a problem with giving them a little flexibility as it relates to the excess that they'll have. I guess I appreciate the fact that we got some private funds, but I don't see any reason to hamstring them or to require them to revert the dollars. Thank you.
Any other comments, Representative Gross?
Mr. Chair.
Representative Hallgard.
Just for clarification, then, is do we know for sure anything about the $500,000? If that was given solely for this road and not intended to revert, then we could certainly amend this and identify that.
I don't think we can answer that question.
Jack's been involved.
Senator Colbeck, do you have any answers?
Just okay. A comment, I would expect Senator Zickman would probably know that answer, and I can text him.
So just a reminder, and just want to clarify, the $1.5 million of general funds, that was last year's, and so all we're dealing with is this amendment, essentially, for $500,000 in the other fund expenditure authority that was provided by a donor, if you will. So, and I can't remember from the hearing if it was specified for operations or road. Any other committee members?
Mr. Chair.
Senator Colbeck.
The understanding about this $500,000 donation from a private donor, and they actually mentioned that donor's name at the committee hearing, is used for the road because they were. They talked about the poles being moved and there's some extra cost being into it. And when this donor went out and saw the cemetery, that was what he wanted to do, to donate that, make that contribution to them and give them authority to spend that money and use that on any overrides on the road. And that's what was testified here, and that's what it was supposed to be used for.
Thank you for the clarification. Any other comments from the committee? Okay. Representative Hallgard.
Well, I haven't looked at it specifically to how to amend that, but we could certainly say that this contribution of $500,000 would be used first for the road. And the other funds that are appropriated could be then revert for ordinary operations of the State Veterans Cemetery if that's what we intend to do. Or if we want to strike that operations portion.
Senator Hunoff.
Well, you just raised the question if we could do it in a letter of intent. I guess the question I'm going to go back to, and I appreciate Representative Gross and Senator Greenfield, but if you're going to say we're going to revert, so then we're taking that donation, let's say hypothetically, I don't know what it's going to cost for the end of that rope, so any of that money would revert to the general fund. I don't believe that that was the intent of the individual that made the donation. That would be the option. I mean, if they're not using their dollars, what they're suggesting here, and I won't be redundant, I respect, but, you know, we could do a letter of intent to say, but then if they have to revert, does that go to the general fund, and is that the intent of the donor that made that pledge to support the finishing of this project?
let me throw this out. Would it, it sounds like the concern is we get the road done. The road gets done. So before these dollars could be used for operational purposes, the road has to be done. Right? Yeah. And I mean, because otherwise, you know, I too don't think we should take dollars away that were provided by a generous donor, but the intent was to get the road done. And after the road is done, if there's leftover dollars, then they should be able to use them, in my opinion. So is, if that's something that the committee agrees with, is this something that you want to look at an amendment, or is this something we can do a letter of intent? I'm throwing it out for the committee to discuss. Representative Gross.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm not trying to take any money away from them either at all on this, but having been there in a couple of different visits, I was there early December, I guess it was, for the wreath ceremony. Mm-hmm. They're going to need some other capital improvements in terms of parking and things like that. And I guess my personal preference would be to say, and for future, instead of saying, and for ordinary operating operations of the Veterans Cemetery, I'd say, and for future capital improvements. And, you know, so they're operating on their own, but they're, if there's any left over, they can put it in a fund for, they're going to need parking. We saw it that day of the wreath ceremony, there were people way up and down the road. They're going to have to do some things like that. And I would rather have the funds available for that. That's my personal preference.
Mr. Chair.
Representative Hallgard.
Yeah, I don't think there's any plan to expand parking because there's really not a need for it except for some special ceremony like that. And that's the only time they're probably going to use that. I just don't think there's a parking lot expansion intended.
I don't necessarily want to re-debate the bill, but I think we have two options. We can pass it, or we can deal with it the way it is, we can amend it, or we can say a letter of intent to address these concerns. Senator Wick.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We do support the regular operations of the Veterans Cemetery. It's one of the line items in the budget that's requested. And one of those regular line items is the ongoing maintenance and performance of the roads inside the cemetery, painting the stripes on the parking lot. I think we can leave the bill the way it is, and the Department of Veterans Affairs has done an incredible job with the money we've already appropriated to them. We have an incredible facility. We have very dedicated members of the oversight board that are going to make sure that this gift and any appropriated dollars we give to them is used for the correct purposes, and I don't think we need any amendments on this bill to do anything with it, because that board and that department does absolutely everything veterans focused and veterans first. So I would support leaving the bill the way it is and supporting a due pass motion and getting it to the floor.
Any further discussion and or action? Representative Howard.
I guess I kind of like the idea of changing that to for future capital improvements of the State Veterans Cemetery, and I'm with Representative Gross. It was my understanding that the ordinary operations of the state cemetery was not going to be an ongoing cost to the taxpayers, that they were going to fundraise that and take care of that on their own. So I like the idea of the amendment.
Okay, we've had good discussion on this, more than I expected. So I think it's time for action. Either somebody...
We have a motion.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have a motion.
Did I miss that?
Yep.
Oh, it was so long ago. I have a motion due pass by Senator Hunhoff and Senator Greenfield. Correct? Okay. Seeing no other comments... Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Hallgard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
18 yea, zero nay.
The motion passes. Thank you. We're going to move to SB 49. Authorize the Department of Military to construct a cold storage building located in Rapid City, South Dakota, and to make an appropriation, therefore, and to declare an emergency.
Mr. Chair.
Senator Hunhoff.
I move due pass of Senate Bill 49.
Second.
I have a motion by Senator Hunhoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald. Comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This was a request we heard at the hearing, and this is for a cold storage building that's located in Rapid City, and it would be a general fund of $225,000 appropriated and a sum of $675,000 in federal fund expenditure authority. This has been on their plan. If you remember, we toured this summer that facility and the needs for that, and I would ask for your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments on the motion? Any further comments? Seeing none, Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
18 yea, zero nay.
That motion passes. We're going to move on to Senate Bill 48, make an appropriation for the redesign and renovation of the Wagner Readiness Center and to declare an emergency.
Hunhoff. Thank you. I move due pass on Senate Bill 48.
Second.
Got a motion by Senator Hunhoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald, due pass on Senate Bill 48. Comments on that motion?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Again, this is a request from the Department of Military, which is the redesign, renovation, and addition of a 6,954 square foot facility to the Wagner Readiness Center. This is an add-on. We were told at the hearing they need more space and accommodating for the activities that they're doing there. There is hereby appropriated from the general fund a sum of $1 million and appropriation of $3 million in federal fund expenditure authority. I would ask for your support of this bill.
Thank you. Any further comments? Any further comments? Seeing none, motions do pass, made by Senator Hunhoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald. Mr. Secretary, you want to call the roll, please?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher. Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
18 yea, zero nay.
That motion passes. We're going to move to Senate Bill 41, revise the appropriation for the construction of a National Guard Readiness Center in Sioux Falls, for the purchase and exchange of property between the state and the Sioux Falls Development Foundation, and to declare an emergency.
Chair.
Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have an amendment. It's 41C, and I would like to offer it at this time.
Second.
41C, is that available online?
It is.
I'm trying to get to it. Let me just look at it. Would you like to move that amendment?
I already have.
Very good. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we have an amendment 41C. Moved by Senator Greenfield, seconded by Representative May. This is a voice vote. All in favor? Sure. Senator Greenfield.
I just want to give a little bit of information here. First of all, on our website, we've already adopted Amendment B, and that was where we changed count to county, Minnehaha County. That hasn't been engrossed, though. So there's, just so there's no confusion, we've already adopted that, and I visited with our LRC staff, and that'll be reflected when the minutes are finished. Now, I mentioned that I wondered if the department would go through the description and confirm whether it was accurate. And Ms. Hone is here, and if it'd be appropriate, she can just confirm that I haven't gone rogue and offered this amendment on my own behalf. It came from the department. They did their homework. They came back to me and said it isn't actually correct. So if we could just, she's nodding, but if she could come forward and maybe state it for the record.
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Good morning.
Connie Hone, Deputy Secretary for the Department of Military. Senator Greenfield, it is correct. I confirmed with Colonel Yost. He's not here today, but I have confirmed, so it's correct.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Any other comments on the motion to amend? Senator Nesseba.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to make sure that there's some ambiguity there on line 22, but I do think that the amendment also deletes the comma after H1.
We're concerned about the comma.
Mr. Chair, it should say except H1 through H5. So the second comma is okay, but the first comma should be taken out there.
He is right. It's an important issue on legal descriptions.
To be a separate amendment.
Mr. Chair, I'll just move to amend the amendment by striking the comma after H1.
Second.
I have a motion by Senator Greenfield to amend the amendment.
Yes.
And seconded by Representative Howard. Do you want to make any more comments or should we act?
Well, Mr. Chair, as we all know, commas are highly, no.
Words matter. All right, voice vote. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Passes. So now we get to have the Amendment 41C as it was amended that we're going to deal with. And that was a motion by Senator Greenfield, second by Representative May. Any further comments on that? Seeing none. This is a voice vote. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. That motion carries. Senator Hunoff?
Mr. Chair, I would like to ask a question of Connie Holm because there was a revision in the breakdown of this readiness center, and I have a question. Good morning. There was a letter sent out with a breakdown of the costs, and in there's a 2023 revised submission of $4 million state dollars. I am trying to find that. Where is that?
Mr. Chair?
Please.
Connie Holm, Deputy Secretary with the Department of Military. So the original start was last year we started with $500,000 in general funds.
Correct.
Let's back up. The very beginning, it was going to be the original cost was going to be $500,000 for construction or $5 million for construction of general funds and $15 million of federal. What we did last year was we passed $500,000. The governor had recommended another $500,000 this year. Mm-hmm. Then at the national level, they said, we're going to move this from a 24 project to 2022. So we had to get all the funds up today. So the $4 million is just the $4 million plus the $500 and the $500. So it's a $5 million general fund construction.
So You're saying it's part of the $5,685,920.
Yep. The original was going to be $5 million construction total. And so we had $500,000 last year. The governor had recommended $500,000 originally, and then we need the next $4 million, the total of $5 million. We need the extra $4 million now so that we can start construction.
That wasn't clear until I got this, so that's why I was asking where the $4 million is coming from, because you have 2023, so that makes me, because this is...
We need it now.
Right,
thank
so
you.
That's why I'm asking the question.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other comments? Do I have a motion?
Mr. Chair.
Senator Hanoff.
I move Senate, to approve Senate Bill 41 as amended.
Second.
A motion by Senator Hanoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald, to approve Senate Bill 41 as amended. Any further comments? Seeing none, Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Senator Duba. Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson. Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Nay.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Excused.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
16 yea, 1 nay, 1 excused.
That motion passes. We're going to move to Senate Bill 51. Make an appropriation to support firefighter training equipment and recruitment efforts in the state and to declare an emergency.
Mr. Chair.
Senator Hunhoff.
I move due pass on Senate Bill 51.
Second. I have a motion by Senator Hunhoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald, due pass. Any comments on the motion?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is an appropriation from the general fund for $2 million to the Department of Public Safety for providing firefighter training equipment and recruitment efforts statewide. It would be used to purchase 2 mobile burn trailers and equipment for use by fire departments statewide, assist with the construction of a fire tower and burn room for use by fire departments statewide, and launch a statewide volunteer firefighter recruitment campaign. I ask for your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments on the motion? Representative Haugard.
Just quickly, the age of most of these volunteers is climbing up rapidly, and so they do need to recruit younger people and try to get people involved in these volunteer fire departments, which make up most of the fire control in the state. So I think it's really important.
Thank you. Okay. Motion before us is due pass, made by Senator Hunhoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald, Senate Bill 51. Mr. Secretary, call the roll, please.
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Absent, excused.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Absent.
Excuse.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
16 yea, 0 nay, 2 excused.
That motion passes. Thank you. We're going to move to Senate Bill 34. Make an appropriation for the enhancement and improvement of state radio infrastructure and to declare an emergency. Senator Hunhoff.
I move due pass on Senate Bill 34.
Second.
And a motion by Senator Hunhoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald, due pass. Comments on the motion?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a allocation appropriation from the general fund for $750,000, and this is to put towers at Redfield and White River. This has been on the list of what towers need to be replaced. I'd ask for your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments on the motion? Seeing none, the motions do pass on Senate Bill 34. It's made by Senator Hunoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald. Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Hallgard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba. Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Absent, excused.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
16 yeas, 0 nay, 2 excused.
A motion passes. Thank you. We're going to move to Senate Bill 31 to make an appropriation of the Department of Labor and Regulation for the modernization of the Reemployment Assistance Enterprise System and to declare an emergency. Senator Hunoff.
Mr. Chair, I move due pass on Senate Bill 31.
Second.
I have a motion by Senator Hunoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald. Due pass. Comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is an appropriation from the general fund of $1.5 million and an appropriation of federal funding for $6.5 million. And what this is to update their IT and modernize their reemployment assistant enterprise system. When they provided testimony, they indicated that it has been out of date and having challenges, and this will certainly help to process those claims in a more timely manner. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further comments? Seeing none, we have a due pass motion by Senator Hunoff, seconded by Representative Fitzgerald on SB 31. Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Hallgard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Absent, excused.
Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Absent, excused.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
Aye.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
16 yea, 2 excused.
That motion passes. Thank you. Okay, last item on the agenda, House Bill 1071, make an appropriation for maintaining the drainage of Lake Andes and to declare an emergency. Representative Fink is on his way. Okay, if we have any questions, Representative Fink will be here shortly. Is there any discussion or action? Representative Hallgard.
I'll just comment that this has been a problem that's been ongoing for several years, and it's been a discussion we've had with tribal leadership over there several years ago now. They made an effort to remediate this themselves, but then were interrupted in that process. So it's languished now again for some years. The problem really arose when the pipe wasn't adequate to do the drainage along that edge of the Lake Andes Lake, and there was tribal housing that was flooded. So they tried to work with it for a time. I think all that housing has either been condemned or moved. So it was a problem for that housing area, and that's what really drew everybody's attention to this. I suppose it's still draining to some extent, but there's obviously a collapse, and I think the collapse in that pipe is in an area where it's 20-some feet deep, so needs attention.
Okay. Further comments, Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do see that there's an amendment that I presume Mr. Fink will want to speak to, so I'll move Amendment 1071C.
Second. Okay, I have a motion to move Amendment 1071C by Senator Greenfield, seconded by Senator Colbeck. If there's any discussion on that. Okay. We're going to be at ease until until Representative Fink is present. He's on his way. Please stand by. Appropriations Committee will come back to order. I'd ask the members to please find their seats. Okay, we are discussing House Bill 1071, an amendment, 1071C, was moved. No actions, further actions have been taken. Representative Fink is here. He's the prime on this. And would you care to address the, give us an update and address the amendment?
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Action. Thank you.
Caleb Fink, District 21, State Representative. Sorry for the delay here this morning, folks. I apologize for that. So this morning you've got before you the amendment, and we'll, I'll take you back. I don't want to rehash everything from our previous. We've got the pipe done in Lake Andes. We now know that there's an issue, and basically we're waiting on getting an estimate on what is it actually going to cost to get that fixed. That estimate is back. We've got an estimate back from some contractors, and we believe we're going to be like just right underneath the $1 million mark to get this thing fixed. And so hence the amendment that's out there for $1 million in ARPA funding so we can get this thing fixed. So, I mean, that really comes down to the crux of it. We've got that. I said we were going to wait until we had a concrete number. We've got a concrete number, and I bring that before you this morning.
So, Representative Fink, the amendment is $1 million, and it's for federal fund authority to use ARPA dollars. Is that correct? Okay. Questions from the committee? Well, we have the good representative here. Representative Howard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Although I saw you out talking to the secretary, so I don't know if you'll be able to answer this question. It would be more for him, probably. But they have, GFMP has $2.9 million in unspent federal fund authority for fiscal year 21. I'm curious as to what specific purposes that was earmarked for.
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
I don't think I can speak to what's in GFMP's budget. All I can tell you is that this project is something that they weren't anticipating. Obviously, we've been working on this for many, many months, and so now we've got a final dollar amount, and we know what it's going to take to get this thing fixed. We believe it's ARPA eligible, and so henceforth why I'm in front of you with the bill this morning.
Questions? Senator Hanoff.
So is the ARPA funds, is GFMP going to use those funds? Is that the source of the agency that would use those ARPA funds to do this project?
Yes, ma'am, that is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Because GFMP owns the structure. So the ARPA funds would go to them. They would need to do that.
Other questions? Representative Mullally.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Okay, I'm confused because I don't see directly in the bill where it says ARPA funds. It just says state and fiscal recovery funds. Is that the same thing?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
I believe per LRC that's the correct language to indicate that it's ARPA. And I'm getting a thumbs up from the LRC staff in the room. So.
Okay. There was additional questions. Representative Haugar, did you have a question? Representative Mills.
Could you provide us a little bit more detail on the estimates that you got? It sounds like you may have you had more than one, and I know you've rounded, and I'm okay with that as long as we have some comfort with the basis of that. Could you provide that, please?
Yep. So the exact estimate off the top of my head was like $990,000 and a few dollars. I mean, we're right at that. And obviously, there's some contingency built into that. Because this is a project that we're using federal dollars on and we're near the tribal land, we've got Section 106 provisions to be dealing with, so we've got all of that built into there. What needs to be done is, and the estimate is, we've got to get dug down to that pipe, pull out the damaged section, redo the base underneath that, because that's essentially what failed us in the first place. Once we've redone the base, then they'll set in new sections of pipe to replace what's there and then reclaim everything above that. I mean, that's the plan. And so because we're at such a depth there, if you remember that, we were talking about this, we're over 20 feet deep in that location. There's just a lot of dirt that's got to be moved, and so hence why there's a quite an additional cost to this.
Additional questions. Senator Hanoff.
Thank you. Would you please refresh our memory? What percentage of this project is on tribal lands?
Madam Chair, Mr. Chair, so the section of pipe that is damaged, okay, is underneath private ground. That particular section of pipe is not under the tribal ground. Part of the rest of the pipe, and I believe it's about half and half of the 6,000-foot pipe, about half of it is underneath tribal ground. But this specific part is not under the tribal ground, but is near it.
Follow up.
So is there, and you mentioned, again, I'm not all familiar with tribal and that, and you mentioned you had to work through that. So do we have to have their permission to do this, to get this project going? Is that part of the process?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
So, and we're going to get to the edge of my knowledge on this, but Section 106 is a federal provision that applies in this situation. And what they're doing is when they do the excavating, I mean, they've got to be looking to make sure that there aren't any Native American artifacts, right? And so we've got to have that oversight both before they start digging as well as, I believe, while they're actually doing the digging. They've got to have somebody out there to take care of that. GF&P has been in contact with the appropriate office to make sure that those folks know that that needs to happen. And because the tribe has been involved with this from my perspective on the local end, they've been well aware of that and are willing to help make sure that we get the right folks in the loop so that we don't have any holdups on that and that process is followed correctly.
Additional questions? Representative Mills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I believe I remember from the testimony that sections of this pipe had easements above them and sections do not. And am I correct that the section that needs to be repaired, there is already an easement in place?
To my knowledge, yes, Mr. Yep.
Well, it's okay. So we have a rule here, Representative Fink. You get three times without going through the chair, and that's donuts. That was number three. Today we're doing tacos. So it's okay.
Mr. Chair, do it's I okay. get deference? I didn't know that was the rule over here now. I was here for 2 years, but that wasn't
We have public chair. Meetings. You're welcome to attend them anytime.
All right, sounds
we,
good.
We make the rules up as we go.
Donuts it is.
Follow-up question, Follow-up. Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chair. So, Representative Fink, can you tell me, I know that the primary goal of the funding is to repair this section of pipe that's settled, sagged, whatever. Are there dollars in this estimate that you've come up with to make any other repairs on other sections of the, once you get down there, on any other sections of the pipe?
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
The plan is we have to address the section that's failing. The rest of the pipe from the inspection report appears to be in very good shape for its age. Down the road, I can't say that there couldn't be additional things that need to be done, but at this point in time, the target and the dollars that we're appropriating or we're looking at here for the authority is specifically just for that repair of that section of failing pipe. That's what we're after.
Follow up.
So within this estimate that you have that's just shy of $1 million, there were no dollars in there to do any contingency, you might say. You know, you get down there and you realize, oh, my gosh, there's an extra 20 feet we need to remove or, you know, that kind of thing. Is there any dollars in the estimate for those unexpecteds?
So, Mr. Chair, or Madam Chair now, sorry. there is within the bid that they've got and the contractor quotes that they've got back, they were looking at some contingency on how many feet there was. Now, we did have the inspection in the pipe, so they're fairly certain they know exactly how much needs to be repaired, but they've built that into that so that we can make sure that we can get the entirety of this particular fix covered under the dollars that we're doing now.
Further question, Representative Haugard.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Representative Fink, you were citing book and page number the other day on something. And I'm wondering, were you citing to the ARPA Act itself or something else?
Madam Chair, Representative Haugard, final rule within ARPA, and I'm going to remember the page numbers off of my head. Stormwater is on page 281 and page 282 of final rule. And I believe there is another provision that was talked about at one point. I believe that's on page 71. And that had to deal with more with the tribal side of this. But 281 and 282, I believe, is what you're wanting to look at.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Senator Wick.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just thinking about this and the times I've heard it, have you looked at how much it is just to replace the whole pipe and be done with it?
Madam Chair. Have we gotten a full bid on what it would cost to replace the whole pipe? No. Part of that is due to some of the pipe is still in good shape and doesn't need to be replaced. Part of that is due to the expense. I mean, we're talking about $1 million just to repair and replace about 200 foot of this 6,000 foot structure. So obviously with that in mind, the cost, if you want to just do the math on your own, I'm sure you could come up with that. I don't know how accurate that would be because obviously we've got some parts of the pipe that are even deeper than this one is, some that are obviously shallower. But the cost of doing the entire project and just replacing the whole shoot and match would be significant. And at this point, if the rest of the pipe is serving the needs that we have, I don't feel that it would be good fiscal prudence to just go ahead and replace the whole thing if we don't need to. Now, down the road, if we continue to have more problems, maybe that's something that we have to look at. But structurally, as they assess the rest of the pipe, the rest of the pipe appears to be in really good shape considering its age.
Follow-up. Thank you, Madam Chair. Just since the federal funding is available under ARPA and since we're stormwater is an acceptable use, do you think now would be a good time to think about just getting it done and not ever having to worry about it again? And that would be, based on my math, if we do averages, somewhere between $25 and $30 million. Seems like a big project, I understand, but have you ever thought about that? I'm not advocating for it. Have you ever thought about it?
Madam Chair, so let me answer it in this way. One of the initial things that was looked at was one of the original designs for this was actually an open-faced trench, okay, and so not having a structure. And so, I mean, this is way back in the 1930s, 40s when they put this thing in. There was some conversation about that. There was a brief, at the beginning of all these discussions about what we were going to do with this structure, there was a brief conversation about should we look into that. And obviously, the more and more we looked into that, due to the private landowner implications above where that structure is now, we were very nervous about that. Also, the cost of that, I mean, that's a would be a major change. And we said, no, it's not worth the risk. We think we need to look at what specifically is wrong with this structure. And if there is something wrong, let's get it fixed. So until now, when you're bringing it up, I mean, had it occurred to me to look into the full cost and try and bring a bill for $30-40 million, who knows, whatever it would be to fix the whole thing? No, it hadn't, just because in my mind, and this is maybe just my farmer brain, if it ain't fixed, don't broke it. No, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? If it ain't broke, don't, anyway. So let's fix the section that's in poor condition, that's failing us, that has the problem, has the possibility to cause more problems down the road, get that fixed, and then keep tabs on this thing going forward with, you know, inspections every once in a while so we know what the structure condition is like, certainly after the big flooding events, things of those nature, and keep on top of it. And I think that's fiscally the best way to handle this.
Additional questions, Senator Hunoff?
Just one more. In your both presentations, you have been the one to present. There are other parties that are involved, and that raises a question in my mind because I know how severe the flooding is. I'm familiar with that. I'm just concerned that, you know, you're carrying water here, but I don't know if everybody else is on the page for you carrying that water and that as we move forward. Just a question, because there were no other testifiers to support this other than yourself. Can you sort of
elaborate? Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
I think actually there's somebody that walked into the room and is sitting behind me that would probably jump at the chance to come up and support what's going on here. I won't speak on his behalf, but I think he would like to do that. But yes, there have been many other parties involved in this, and I've taken the lead on and bringing this forward.
Well, I'll invite whoever would like to come up if they'd like to say a few words. Just real briefly, we have to move on to our next item here at 10 o'clock.
I'll be very brief, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Members of the committee, sorry for racing in late, but everything's going on today. So, my name is Ross Garlick Bell. I am the registered lobbyist for the Yankton Sioux Tribe. They are very supportive of this legislation. They found it great to be working with the state to find a solution to this problem that caused a lot of flooding to their homes. I believe 36 in total were damaged at Lake Andes. As you know, for the tribe, housing is a critical situation already due to funding issues. So to lose 36 homes was a dramatic situation for the tribal members. So again, we're happy to see this moving on and hopefully see it pass and get it resolved so it doesn't happen again the next time a cyclone bomb hits the area. So thank you again and hope that helps.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Any other questions from the committee? Seeing none, I'd entertain a motion. I apologize. We have the amendment still. Thank you. Senator Greenfield moved amendment 1071C, seconded by Senator Colbeck. Any further comments on that amendment? Senator Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to thank Representative Rain Man for coming forward and providing that. He who can tell us what page certain references are on. I would very strongly encourage us to adopt the amendment and to keep this moving and see if we can't, you know, come to an ultimate agreement. I think that it's extremely important that we address this issue, though.
Thank you. Seeing no other comments on the amendment, the motion for the amendment, this is a voice vote. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no?
No.
That carries. We are now dealing with House Bill 1071 as amended. Representative Howard? Discussion. Go ahead.
Okay. I just want to make a couple of comments on this. I appreciate the fact that the good representative is bringing this forward and doing this in the legal way, according to state statutes, because GFMP, as we know, has $2.9 million in unspent federal fund authority in this fiscal year. So I appreciate the fact that they didn't just go out and spend that without, because we know that was for specific other purposes. I'm still going to be a no on this because these are still taxpayer funds. We're talking federal fund authority. These are federal dollars. These are taxpayer funds. I believe GFMP has the funds necessary, and they should have already been taking care of this. They have plenty of funds to take care of these, but as we know, they're more concerned lately with splashy headline-catching projects that don't even get legislative approval before they go out and start doing it. So I'm going to be a no on this, not because it's not necessary. It is necessary, and it needs to be done. But GFMP has the funds to already do this, and they should have already done this.
Action and or
Mr. Chair.
Further comments? Senator Brayling.
I move due pass on House Bill 1071.
Yes. I have a motion by Senator Brayling, seconded by Representative Gross. Any further comments? Seeing none, it's a due pass motion. Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
As amended.
As amended.
Representative Gross.
Aye.
Representative Fitzgerald.
Aye.
Representative Duba.
Aye.
Senator Wick.
Aye.
Representative Haugard.
Aye.
Senator Nezeba.
Absent, excused.
Senator Johnson. Representative May.
Aye.
Representative Mills.
Aye.
Senator Maher.
Aye.
Representative Mullally.
Aye.
Senator Colbeck.
Aye.
Senator Sutton.
Aye.
Senator Greenfield.
Aye.
Senator Breitling.
Aye.
Representative Howard.
No.
Senator Hunhoff.
Aye.
Representative Carr.
Aye.
16 yay, 1 nay, 1 excused.
The motion passes. We have no further business as a joint committee today. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
I have a motion by Senator Greenfield to adjourn, seconded by Senator Sutton. All in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. We are adjourned.